Hello and welcome to everyone. This is my interview number 100, and of course, the legend is here again. Here is our guest, Modestas Bukauskas, or better to say, Modestas the Baltic Gladiator Bukauskas. So, Modestas, first question, how did you feel inking UFC, you know, making Lithuania another country on the list of the greatest MMA promotion in the world?
Mate, it means a hell of a lot. Like I say, I'm very patriotic towards my birth country, my home country. Like I say, every time I go out there, I always get like these tingles just because it just feels like it's home. So to be able to put my country on the map, you know, like even UFC done a post the other day, they had the Lithuanian flag there showing the countries that are being represented. You know, it's a big deal for me. And now we've just seen that actually Yulia Stoylarenko has just got into the UFC as well. So, you know, I think this is just, you know, the start of something big, the start for now, you know, more Lithuanian athletes to be able to go out there and you know, show themselves on the world stage. And like I say, I can't wait to go out there and put on more spectacular performances. And yeah, let the voice be heard everywhere that fighters from Lithuania are tough cookies.
Absolutely. Coronavirus pandemics slapped the world. So how did you train during the pandemics? I was watching your videos, you were training literally every day. How did you deal it?
Yeah, literally, it was just a case of adjusting slightly. I mean, listen, when you've got your head coach living in the room next door, there's no way that you're going to be able to stop yourself from training, you know what I mean? Literally, it's just a couple of steps away and I've got my head coach sitting right there. Another thing that's helped that he's done an amazing job is, you know, building a gym in our garden downstairs. I've had the facilities like nothing really much changed. Like I said, when the restrictions were at the beginning, it just meant that aside from the sessions with my dad, I'd have to go on like more runs and stuff like that, and you know, drill techniques with my dad and stuff. But then as soon as restrictions became lifted a little bit more, I mean, you know, maybe bending the rules a little bit, but you know, I got training partners to come to my house and we literally were able to train, you know, as normal, and we were able to do the sparring, do the drilling and stuff like that. One thing that was very useful and insightful was the fact that I was able to do all my training specific to how I wanted to train and what I needed to work on, which I've got to give massive credit to all my training partners, because if it wasn't for them, I wouldn't have been working on the things that I needed to go out and, you know, put on the performance that I needed. So, you know, usually when I'm in normal training, I'm just going to a session and it's like you're doing all the stuff that, you know, that the coach wants to teach or whatever, or you know, whatever drill that they want to do or the technique. Whereas now I can do all the techniques that I want to go over, the what I want to learn and stuff like that, which is great. So, you know, obviously I always want to try and pick up new skills and new techniques and stuff like that. But sometimes you need to go over stuff and, you know, you need to, like I say, train more specifically to yourself. You need to be a little bit selfish in this sport. And it was amazing that I was able to do that. And it was amazing to have training partners that were willing and able to help. And I can't be more thankful for that.
Great. So did this pandemic change your life? I mean, you earned some of the best results, and so, I mean, you used this opportunity in the best possible way.
Yeah. Do you know what? The pandemic, to be honest, it gave me sort of time to reflect a bit more on myself, to work on other things and stuff like that. It wasn't necessarily, you know, I mean, it was a bad, like, you know, it's a bad thing for like the whole world or everything and everything. But, you know, obviously being signed to the UFC and stuff like that with, you know, your boss, he's always trying to overcome stuff and adapt and, you know, change the environment and stuff like that. And he was able to do so well. The fact that he's able to keep running shows, keep people getting paid and stuff like that is absolutely amazing. Because, you know, I have to admit, it's, you know, when you're losing sponsors and, you know, they're, you know, people that have helped out and they've done it, again, they've done an amazing job, you know, it gets to the point where it's like, well, then money becomes an issue. And it's like, you're supposed to fight at one point and you thought everything's going to be fine and then you don't get it. So it's been a very crazy, turbulent time, but it's never demotivated me, took away any inspiration for me. I think the fact that I'm always trying to train to get better and improve myself has always given me the motivation during the whole time. And I knew something would happen, and then obviously the fight then got announced and stuff like that. So nothing ever fazed me that sort of didn't go exactly to plan.
You trained for Vinicius Moreira, then you found out that he was positive to Corona. Knowing your fighting style, you prepared for a grappler. And to be honest, if you kept the fight standing, it would have been the end of the road. But then Michalidis came. How did you feel? I mean, short notice change is very, very, how to say, very stressful for many fighters. How did it affect you?
To be honest, the stuff that I was training would have been suited for any fighter. Honestly, it just made my defense of the grappling and the wrestling just that much better. So realistically, all the stuff that I was training would have worked for no matter what opponent I had, because I already know I had the striking base and I know that I can implement that style in the fight myself. So all I knew was, in my opinion, Michalidis was a more well-rounded fighter. He had striking, wrestling, and jiu-jitsu. He was very good on the floor as well. So he had a much more all-rounded game, but it would never sort of negate what I needed to do, because the whole time I was training to stop the takedowns and to negate all the stuff on the floor with the submission. So I knew that the striking would take care of itself, and then okay, if it entered those grappling areas, I'll know exactly what to do. So realistically, nothing changed. As soon as they announced the opponent, I'm like, okay, well, I've got a tougher opponent, but at the same time, it just means better for me because I've got a higher profile guy that will lift me up more if I go and beat him. So yeah, man, nothing really changed. It just made me more excited because I knew that how good my opponent was.
Can you describe the technical approach of Travis Brown elbow finish? As well as I've seen, Michalidis was shooting forward, then he shoot to the side. And it was probably a mistake because you finished your last fight via Travis Brown, but when the opponent moved to the left, if he shoot in directly, nothing would have happened. But can you do a technical approach, please?
Yeah. So technically, I could have stopped the takedown. I chose not to. So realistically, elbows wasn't even going through my thought process at that time. I was literally thinking, okay, I've got the overhook and I've got an underhook. I can defend this takedown. We can go into the second round. We can continue on as normal, right? But what happened was, I think there was about 10 seconds left, or the clapper went or whatever. And then all I hear is, and like I say, from in that sort of arena where there's not that much noise and stuff like that, you can really hear your corners. And I always manage to hear my dad over anything, any other voice or whatever, or crowd, I can always hear my dad. And he shouted to me, elbows, elbows, elbows. And we've been practicing those elbows like in the gym, like with a pad and stuff like that, to try and get the pinpoint accuracy on the right spot on the head. And I saw it like clear as day. As soon as he said, I'm like, well, his head is right here. I literally gave up the underhook. I had an underhook to stop. I gave up the underhook to land the elbows. And the thing is, at that point, I knew exactly that, because his head was like in a perfect spot. It was like literally like placed it there for me to just hit and strike. So at the end of the day, I wanted to go and finish the fight. So I'm going to take any opportunity to finish the fight. So, you know, when the opportunity presented itself, along with what my dad was shouting me in the corner, that was it.
Yeah, it was great, and generally, I hope you will reach rank status very soon, because looking back at strikers at the division, I believe only two or three strikers could trade bars with you. I don't know whether you agree or not, but what is your thoughts on general weight class and strikers? And I assume, according to what I've seen, I assume you're one of the best in the division when it comes to striking.
Oh, I appreciate that, man. I mean, listen, there's been a lot of emphasis on the striking, but there's going to be times where I'm going to be taking people down and mauling them on the floor. Like I say, I've not even managed to even show those sort of sides of my skill set just yet, just because I've been working so heavily on stopping takedowns and, you know, imposing my striking. But yeah, I feel like I'm the best striker in the division, and I'm ready to go out and show that. Like I say, every fight, every win, every step that I need to take, I'm gonna go out and blitz my opponents. Like I say, they should be fearful of the striking, because another thing that they don't realize is that my striking is only getting better. Like, it's not like that last fight it was the same, and I'm content with it. I always want to improve. I always do things to tweak it and get it better. So I'm just trying to be a more dangerous fighter every single time. And yeah, like I say, I'm going to take the appropriate steps and just keep moving up the ranks, and then go towards that UFC light heavyweight belt.
Yeah, generally, I hope Lithuania is going to have a ranked fighter very soon. Can you just say what we spoke last time?
Nabojica.
That's it, Modesto. It's great. This is a message, you know. This is a message for fans, and in my country, it means don't be afraid of success, you know. And people are kind of very conservative towards UFC in my state, despite we had a lot of UFC fighters or so. Bulgaria not, but the other part of me is from Serbia, you know. And people are very much still conservative about UFC here, but it's slowly coming. But you know, just like you're the first innovator in Lithuania, I'm trying to do something in Serbia that is kind of not taking well or so. So I assume you know nothing on your next opponent right now, but go ahead.
I have an opponent, but obviously I can't say anything. So I'll let that be known whenever the time.
Oh, it's awesome. It's awesome. We expect another victory, and I hope next year Lithuania is going to have top 10 fighter.
My man, definitely. That is what we're working towards. And yeah, like I say, I can't wait. Every single fight, every single step, we're going to take it and we're going to go all the way to the top.
Yeah, great, great. Thank you so much for this interview. Let me now edit it, and I hope in 2-3 hours we will post it. I will
awesome.
Send you.
All right. Thank you so much, my man. Really nice talking to you always.
All right. Thank you so much.
Have a great day.
Have a great day.
All right. Take care, my brother.